With your Bibles in your hand, I want to go and revisit the 13th chapter of Matthew. The last three messages that you have received have come from the 13th chapter of Matthew. Amen. As we've been looking at the parables of Jesus, I'm going to go all the way down to the 53rd verse and read through the 58th verse, and then we want to go to Luke, the 4th chapter, 31 through 32, and 40 and 41. Praise God. Matthew chapter 13, verse 53, starting, says, "When Jesus had finished these parables, he left there, and after coming to Nazareth, his hometown, he began teaching them in their synagogue, and they were astonished and said, 'Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers? What is the source of his authority? Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? And are not his brothers James and Joseph and Simon and Judas and his sisters? Are they not living here among us? Where then did this man get all this wisdom and power?' And they took offense at him, refusing to believe in him. But Jesus said to them, 'A prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown and in his own household.' And he did not do many miracles there in Nazareth, because of their unbelief." Turn with me to Luke chapter 4, starting at verse 31. Praise God. I'm going to read in your hearing verses 31 and 32, and then we're going to drop down to verse 40 and read verse 40 and 41. Are you there? "Then he came down from the hills of Nazareth to Capernaum, a city of Galilee on the shore of the sea. And he was teaching them on the Sabbath. And they were surprised, almost overwhelmed at his teaching, because his message was given with authority and power and great ability. While the sun was setting, marking the end of the Sabbath day, all those who had any who were sick with various diseases brought them to Jesus, and laying his hands on each one of them, he was healing them, exhibiting his authority as Messiah. Demons also were coming out of many people, shouting, 'You are the Son of God.' But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak, because they knew that he was the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed." The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to our God. You may be seated in the presence of our God. I want to talk to you this morning from the subject, contrasting responses to Jesus. Unbelief versus belief. Again, contrasting responses to Jesus, : unbelief versus belief. How many of you all know that everybody that comes to worship is not a believer?
Amen.
Praise God. There are all kinds of people in congregation. There are those who are believing, those who are the saints of God, who anticipate hearing a word from the Lord. There are those who are anxious to hear what is going to be said, with the possibility that they might be saved. There are others who come because they are just nosy. They want to see what everybody else got on. They want to see what the word is, Maybe they're looking for a date. Then some people come just out of tradition, because it's just normal for people to worship on a Saturday or a Sunday. There are different contrasting responses to Jesus. Amen? In the 13th chapter of Matthew, Jesus had taught them in parables. Now, parables are earthly stories that have a higher meaning. Amen. They have a spiritual meaning. Jesus was very competent in dealing with what people understood so that they could kind of appreciate what they did not understand. How many of you all know that God's ways are not our ways?
Amen.
And his thoughts are not our thoughts. And so in order for us to receive spiritual things, Jesus taught using physical or earthly stories. Amen? And so he gave these parables. They're all in the 13th chapter of Matthew. He talked about a sower and a seed. He talked about weeds among wheat. He talked about the mustard seed. He talked about the leaven, the hidden treasure, a costly pearl, and a dragnet. After he spoke in parables, after he taught in parables, Jesus went back home to Nazareth. Hallelujah. And Nazareth was an interesting place. Amen. It had a reputation that nothing good could come out of Nazareth. As a matter of fact, when Jesus was born, people wondered how in the world could a king be born in Nazareth. Not only that, but Herod had put out a decree. He really wanted to kill Jesus. And so Jesus, when he went back home, he faced opposition. How many of y'all know that sometimes you're without honor in your own house?
Amen.
In your own city.
Amen.
Amen. Because people have a tendency to remember you as you used to be.
Right.
You know, when you were growing up, they remember the bad things, the mistakes that you made. And many times they can't see the good things that have happened to you for thinking about the past.
Right.
And if you're not careful, they will try to keep you in the past.
Amen.
Amen. But how many of you all are glad that you're not what you been through? You don't look like hallelujah, what you've been through. And God has brought you a mighty long way. Hallelujah. I'm glad that God has taken my mind. Amen. The Holy Ghost has taken my mind. I don't need my old mind. Hallelujah. You know, people always talk about, I want to give you a piece of my mind. Listen, if your mind has not been transformed, we don't need to hear from your mind. Amen? Because there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. We want to hear from God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You didn't come to True Light this morning to hear from me. You came here to get a word from on high.
Amen.
Hallelujah. My words, praise God, they may be good intention, but they don't have no power behind
them. Amen.
But when I preach God's word,
that's right.
God's word has the power,
yes, it does,
to transform your life.
Amen.
God's word has the power to lift up heavy burdens. You may have come in here burdened down, but you can leave out of here with a glide in your stride and a pep in your step.
Amen.
Maybe you came in here not feeling the best in your body, but you come to the greatest physician that the world has ever known.
Amen.
He goes by the name of Jehovah Rapha. And whatever you can have, he can heal.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so this is a right time, you come to the right person, and Jesus has got something for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But when he went back home, those people looked at him and remembered what they thought they knew about him. When you look at verse 53 through 58, there are some phrases that they use. How many of y'all know that when people use phrases, many times they have a negative connotation behind them? And so they use sayings like, where did he get all this wisdom?
Right.
He hasn't been to no university.
Right.
He didn't matriculate through any colleges that we know about. Where did he get this wisdom? Isn't he the carpenter's son? You know, Jesus was the oldest in his family. And he was apprenticed to Joseph. Joseph was a carpenter, and so Jesus learned carpentry from his father. Amen. They asked the question, isn't his brothers and sisters here? Let us know that Jesus was not the only son that Mary had. Amen. He had other brothers. How many of y'all know that even in the same house, folk are different?
Yeah.
Amen. If you got, you're a parent, you know, if you have more than one kid, all your kids are different. Amen. And in Jesus' house, he had brothers and sisters, probably them not even believing in him. Then they said, is not this his mother? His brethren and sisters, are not they all here with us? In other words, what they were saying was, we know this boy.
Right.
It's the same boy that, you know, they got this fallacious story out that somehow her mama got pregnant without sleeping with anybody. Ain't he the boy that down the street, you know, that Jesus boy?
Yes, sir.
And that's how people will treat you.
Amen.
They think they know you. Right, many times people come and ask me, do you know so-and-so? And I say, I know about him. And the reason why I say I know about him is because I'm still trying to get familiar with me.
Right.
See,
right.
You don't even know yourself.
Right.
If you knew yourself, you wouldn't be surprised by what come out of your mouth. You wouldn't be surprised at some of the actions that you do. Amen.
Amen.
So we're trying to get to know ourselves, and the more we know about ourselves, the more we want to know about Jesus.
Amen.
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 Yep. So in Nazareth, Jesus could not do any great works. Because you know what is a killer to Jesus' power? It's unbelief. If you have unbelief, the Lord is not going to do anything around you.
Amen.
Amen. You can pray, and your prayers will be amiss. You can cry, you can do whatever you can, but if you don't have faith in the Lord, nothing's going to happen.
Amen.
And so in Nazareth, Jesus could not do any great works. Matter of fact, when he went back home, instead of them wanting to cheer him, they wanted to kill him. How many of y'all know that folk are assassins? I believe the OJs call them backstabbers. Some folks are smiling in your face all the time. They're trying to take your place. And sometimes even in your family, you know, even brothers and sisters, sometimes they don't mind as long as you junior. As long as you on their level. Amen. But don't flex your muscles. Don't get high. Don't get to a point where you are doing better than. Because a lot of times the reason why folks because you have excelled and they're still struggling. Oh, not your family. I'm talking about another family. Amen. And sometimes the reason why people struggle is trying to help everybody in the family who should be doing better than what they're doing.
Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah. You remember Joseph in the book of Genesis. Amen. Joseph was a dreamer. And when God gave him dreams, now he was a little, you know, cocky. Because instead of him keeping it to himself, he told it to his brothers. And the Bible said they hated him the more. And then his daddy gave him a coat of many colors. Can you imagine what the boys thought about him when he put that coat on? Now mind you, Dad didn't give me no coat. But he got a coat. And he used to strut. Around in his coat. And the Bible said they hated him the more. You know what they did to him? They put him in a pit. And they would have killed him. But they sold him into slavery. You all know that story. That's how they got to Egypt. But the things that people mean for your ill, God will turn it around.
Amen.
Sometimes when folk want to press you down, that's the time God will pick you up.
Amen.
Amen. You may be the least and the last in your family. Folk didn't think you would amount to very much. But I'm glad that man looks on the outward appearance. But God looks at the heart.
Amen.
And if you got a heart for God, God will take you places that nothing else can get you there. God will have you talking to people you would never meet on your own. All because you have a heart for God and you have faith in God. Amen? Now there are three major reasons why they rejected Jesus. I want to give them to you. Amen. Reason number one, they did not understand the source of his wisdom and power. Praise God. They did not understand the source of his wisdom and power. They thought they knew Jesus. But they were only looking at him from a physical perspective. They didn't understand that before Jesus ever showed up in Bethlehem, that he is from everlasting to everlasting. Hallelujah. Before the beginning ever began to begin, Jesus is. Hallelujah. In John chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same as in the beginning, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. You keep reading down, it says, and that Word became flesh. And when the Word became flesh, Jesus came down and was born in Bethlehem. But Bethlehem was not his beginning.
Right.
So they wondered why he could talk with such wisdom and authority. They didn't understand that he had a first-hand knowledge of what he was talking about.
Amen.
You see, when Jesus talked about a tree, he understood the tree because he planted the tree.
Yes, sir.
If Jesus talked about the celestials, he understood because he hung them in their sockets.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus talked about whatever he talked about, he had first-hand knowledge because nothing was made that was made without him. Hallelujah. And if you want to know something about your life, you need to go to Jesus. Because he made you. He formed you. He knows everything about you. He knows your thoughts before you think. Hallelujah. So they thought they understood him, and so they were wondering, where did he get his knowledge? Where did he get his wisdom? Where did he get his power? I got news for you. If you get hooked up with Jesus, If you get plugged in, folks will wonder where you got your power. Hallelujah. Because you know what? When you receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, God gives you a power pack. It's called the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And you can feel the power just by showing up. You don't have to say nothing. You don't have to wear a button. You don't have to have a hat on. Talk about Jesus saved. You don't have to do it. You just show up. And the Holy Spirit will show out. Amen?
Amen.
So they did not understand the source of his wisdom and power. When Jesus spoke word. How many of y'all know there's power in the word?
Oh,
amen. Hallelujah. And he had to speak word because he is the word. So when you heard Jesus speak, he was quoting himself. Everything Jesus said in the New Testament, he had already written down in the Old Testament.
Amen.
So the living word was speaking the written word so that you could get prepared to go home to be with the word. Hallelujah. Wow. Praise God. And so they didn't understand his wisdom and his power. The second thing that why they rejected him was because they were offended because of him. You ever been around somebody and they just, you hated that you were around them? I mean, I don't know, if something was just out of whack. You found yourself doing this. You're just inching away from them. You just didn't want to be in the vicinity of them. Amen. You didn't want to be associated with them. Well, that's how they were with Jesus. Because he was different. Somebody say different.
Different.
Because he was not like everybody else, it offended some folk. Can I tell you something? If you got Jesus in you, you will be offensive.
Amen. Amen.
Because light and darkness don't have communion with one another.
That's true.
Amen. Amen. And so if you got light in you, when you show up and people are living in darkness, you don't have to say anything. They get fidgety.
Yes, they do.
Because the devil can't be around Jesus long. You know, that's the reason why you can talk about politics all you want. And folk will talk with you. You can talk about sports all you want and folk will be with you. You can talk about the gossip going around in town and folk will talk for days about that. Mm-hmm. But the minute you say Jesus,
oh, yeah.
Well, look at the clock.
That's true.
I got something else to do. You know, that because light and darkness don't commune with each other.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. But I would rather have Jesus than silver or gold.
Yeah.
I would rather have Jesus than riches untold. I would rather have Jesus than anything this world can afford. Give me Jesus, because he's more than enough. But he offended people in Nazareth. And so they didn't want to be associated with him. You'll find that in verse 57. Amen. And then the third reason that they didn't believe in him was because they had no faith. They could not believe. Amen. Have you ever talked to somebody about Jesus? And they looked at you as if you were telling them a fable. You can talk to people, you can tell them that God loves them. You can tell them that God has a wonderful plan for their life. If they would just turn their life over to Jesus, everything will smooth out. You can tell people that. But if they don't have the love of God in them, it's just like telling them a fairy tale. They can't receive the things of God.
Amen.
I'm just going to throw this in free just because you're here. Amen. In order to receive God, God has to give you saving faith to even receive him.
Yep.
Because you and I don't have the capacity to even receive divine power unless God gives us saving faith. Amen. And when God gives you that faith, then you can exercise faith in him. When you do that, then God gives you everything that heaven's got.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And when you taste and see that the Lord is good, you really don't want anything else.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Unbelief results in bitter fruit. Unbelief hurts the unbeliever because the unbeliever loses his or her life. What would profit a man if he should gain this whole world and lose his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for a soul? A soul is a terrible thing to lose.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I heard Minister Derek talking about Solomon, this great king who wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. When God asked him, what do you want me to do for you? Solomon didn't ask for riches. He didn't ask for material thing. He said, God, I need wisdom in order to lead your people. And God was so excited that he didn't ask for what most folk asked about, that he gave him everything else. And so this king dined at the best restaurants. He got busy with the best looking women. He drank the best wine. He smoked the best cigars. He had the best of everything. And when he had experienced all that life could offer him, you know what he said? He said, everything is empty without God.
Amen.
And he leaves on record that you can run to things that you think you need,
yep,
but if it ain't God, it's just empty.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Unbelief hurts the unbeliever. Mm-hmm. And one of these days, they will spend eternity in hell. Mm-hmm. Don't you let anybody tell you that there is not a hell. That when you're dead, you're done. Nothing could be further from the truth. Hallelujah. Because after you live this life, you got to live eternally some way.
Amen.
And it would be bad to live in hell and then go to hell.
Amen.
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 Unbelief hurts the unbeliever's neighbors and friends. Do you know that God wants you to be a witness for him? God wants you to let your light shine so that others can know that there's a reality in serving a true and a living God.
Yeah.
So if you're wasting your life, you're actually keeping blessings from your neighbors and friends. You're cheating them out of the opportunity that God can use through you to reach them.
Praise
God. What a wasted life for a person to live their life outside of Christ and not be a witness for the Lord. Because when you're done, some folk will be glad you're gone.
Amen.
Amen. You know, it would be tragic for you to live your life and folk be glad that you're gone. Amen. You want people to be glad that you came through here. Amen. And you've got to live your life in concert with the Lord. Unbelief hurts Christ. It cuts his heart. Because he longs to give life to everybody. Amen. God wants to save you. God wants to lavish his love on you. Because you really don't have life without Christ.
Amen.
You may think you're living. You're not living. You're just existing without Christ.
Yes, sir.
But the moment you receive the Lord Jesus Christ into your life, he opens up a whole new world for you.
Yes, he does.
Amen. And even if you don't have as much money as the next person, God will give you peace of mind.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
God will give you joy, unspeakable joy.
Yes.
God will put happiness inside of you.
Yes.
And I don't know if you can buy that at the supermarket.
Yes.
I don't think Macy's carries it. I don't think Kohl's has it.
Right.
Amen. But if you have it, it's better than gold.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen.
Unbelief hurts everybody because God cannot work where there is unbelief. Unbelief shuts God out. Amen. As a matter of fact, that's the reason why if you're a prayer intercessor or if you believe in prayer, you can't pray around everybody. Because some folk don't believe. And if a person don't believe, you don't need them in your prayer circle. Because the Bible says if two touch and agree, that they can have the desires of their heart. And sometimes the reason why we preempt our prayers is by inviting folk who put a kink in the prayer circle. Hallelujah. People who just taking up space, who are operating in unbelief, and they can short circuit God's blessing. Because God is not going to do any great works where there is unbelief.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
So what happens when you're in a place where people don't believe? If you're in a family, you're saved and they don't believe, what do you do? Hallelujah. Well, here's what you do. You let your light shine.
Amen.
In the middle of it.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
And then when you get able and under the Spirit's direction, move.
Amen.
Because if you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got. You know what the definition of insanity is? Doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result.
Amen.
Birds of a feather flock together. You can't soar with eagles hanging around turkeys.
Amen.
Oh my goodness. If you want to soar, you've got to be around saved folk.
Amen.
You want to be around people who have faith. Because the Lord said, if you have a faith as a grain of mustard seed, you can speak to the mountain and the mountain will get out of your way.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So you know what Jesus did when the people wouldn't receive him in Nazareth? He moved. And he set up headquarters in a place called Capernaum. Hallelujah. Now Capernaum was also in Palestine, but Capernaum was a merchant place. It was a place where the ships came through. Different people of prominence came through Capernaum. Amen. It was a metroplex. And Jesus took up residence in Capernaum. And the Bible says that Jesus began preaching and teaching the word in Capernaum. Now the people in Capernaum were amazed as well. But they were amazed in a positive way, whereas Nazareth was amazed in a negative way. You see, when Jesus shows up, you will be amazed.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
But you may not be amazed in a positive way. You're just amazed because there's a whole bunch of commotion going on. You can't understand it. You can't receive it because you're not connected. But when you went to Capernaum, the people were amazed because they had faith to believe. And because they had faith to believe, hallelujah, Jesus did miraculous works in Capernaum. I don't know about you, but I want to be in Capernaum. Hallelujah. I want to be in a place where when Jesus shows up, he shows out. Hallelujah. I want to be in a place where the sick recover. Hallelujah. I want to be in a place where when people hear the word, they get excited about the word, and they get on fire for the word, and they want to operate in the word. Hallelujah. Because God is going to do some miraculous things when you are a recipient and a believer in his word.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of them 11 says. You got to believe on Jesus. You got to believe that he can do what he said he can do. Hallelujah. And so when he came to Capernaum, there were people who were lame. There were people who were had demon spirits. There were people who had all manner of diseases. And you know what? When they brought them to Jesus, they didn't leave like they came. Hallelujah. They may have come not seen, but when they left Jesus, they could see 20/20. When they came seeking Jesus, they may not have been able to walk, but when they came to Jesus, he would tell them to take up your bed and walk. And folk who had never walked before began to walk. Matter of fact, they ran. Hallelujah. And so Jesus was doing miraculous things. Why? Because they had faith to believe. My question to you, true love, is do you have faith to believe that God can do everything but faith?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Do you come into these doors with anticipation of what God is going to do?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I look every Sunday at what God might do because he's a miracle worker. Hallelujah. He is a great physician. Sometimes you know, I want to believe, but it just looked like circumstances get too big for me. I've got some good news for you. You can pray and say, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. And we serve a God who loves you so much until he'll work on your unbelief while he's working on the belief. Hallelujah. He'll give you miracles in your belief and yet work on your unbelief. Amen.
Amen.
So I love God.
Amen.
I love him. I praise him. Because he's been mighty good to me. Hallelujah. I remember when I was a little boy in Flint, Michigan. Hallelujah. I was at Canaan Baptist Church, sitting up in the balcony. But I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest. Lay down your weary one, lay down your head upon my breast. I came to Jesus. Just as I was weary, I was wounded, and I was sad, but I found in him a resting place. And the Lord has made me glad. I may not be what I ought to be, but I'm a far cry from what I used to be. And if you're not seeing what you think you ought to see, be patient with me, because God is not through with me yet. But I'm thankful today that he saved my soul. I'm thankful today that he made me whole. I'm thankful to be on his team. Be a believer. Have faith in God.
Amen.
Trust him. And don't doubt him.
Amen.
Because he will do what he said he will do.
Amen.
Maybe you come to True Light this morning, or maybe you're listening on the internet, and your life has not been what you wanted it to be. Maybe things are not coming together, and you know that you need to change. I want to recommend Jesus to you. If you give your life to the Lord, it doesn't mean that everything is just going to smooth out all at once. But God will start right where you are and elevate you to where you ought to be. Hallelujah. And so I want to invite you to come to Jesus. Won't you like to stand to your feet? If you've never received Christ as your personal Savior,